Great. So we're going to get started. Thanks to everyone for joining, and thanks especially to our panelists for this discussion of AI and national intelligence. Somebody pointed out that 2017 was not the year that AI became self-aware, but that policymakers became aware of AI. I think that's true. Most notably, maybe in the news just over the last week, on Friday, Vladimir Putin addressed in a lecture at a school saying that whoever wins the AI race will rule the world. And what I took from this is we're not going to invite Vladimir Putin to give a lecture at our kids' school. What Elon Musk took from it was a tweet saying, "It begins," with a link to Vladimir Putin's speech, followed by the most likely cause of World War III will be an AI arms race. So without putting too much pressure on this panel, can you tell us what you're worried about? Can you tell us what the opportunities are, where we need to be investing as a nation, where the gaps are in our R&D, and where are opportunities to embed AI technologies into other technologies that we already have fielded? So those are some of the opportunities we'll be talking about. We're going to have 45 minutes of discussion up here, then 30 minutes of Q&A. We ask that you submit questions on index cards, and we don't yet have the AI that will be fielding those questions, so Rhonda will be providing expert judgment and clustering those questions. Although IASD, I guess, would be another opportunity for doing some unsupervised learning on that.
Right.
So I want to introduce our distinguished panel. We have to my right Kristen Summers, who's the technical delivery lead at IBM Watson Public Sector Global Delivery. We have Gunnar Carlson, who's the co-founder of IASD, and a past professor of mathematics at Stanford. We have, to his right, Dr. Brian Sadler, senior research scientist for intelligence systems, the U.S. Army. And then to his right, Lisa Porter, executive vice president of InQtel and director of InQtel Labs. So to start with, what are the things, short of nuclear war, that do worry you most about the trend lines in machine learning? And Kristen, let's start with you, and please don't worry us so much that we start tweeting.
Yeah, so, I'm not worried by a lot of the things that are typically referred to, just to say that. I'm not worried that we're close to AI sort of taking over, or what worries me more than that actually are inflated expectations and mismatches between the kinds of problems that we have and models that we've trained and the things that people want to do with it. And I think people often, they want these very long-term, very overarching grand solutions that AI can ultimately deliver, but there are a lot of pieces to them, and we need to recognize all of those parts, and there are AI problems residing in each one of those parts. So to recognize, for instance, what is being claimed in a piece of text and what the sentiment is around that claim, like those are tasks in themselves before you then combine that with other evidence and decision-making support and what you're going to do about it. And each of those pieces needs to be addressed, and the error tends to accumulate. So one of the things that worries me is error propagation, and propagation both of the errors that we have and recognition of the propagated uncertainty, right? Each piece of that system is going to have some degree of certainty, and we need to really understand how to combine those so that when there is some kind of outcome, we know how to interpret that in light of all of the pieces of processing that led up to it.
Gunnar, what, in addition to the sort of mechanical problems of error propagation, do you worry about?
So again, I'm not worried, actually. I actually see a huge opportunity instead. And I think if, to the extent that I am worried, is that we don't take full advantage of it. My feeling is that, in fact, artificial intelligence, when I heard about it at first, was very much narrow artificial intelligence. Solve very simple cognitive tasks repeatedly over and over again. And I think the opportunity that's in front of us now is, if we recognize it, is that in fact, artificial intelligence should not be entirely artificial. It should, for the most part, be augmenting and helping human intelligence by performing and doing the things that we don't do quite as well, perhaps, but even doing so in an interactive way. So in other words, I think there's a technical or scientific challenge there in building the artificial intelligence so that it's justifiable, so that one understands it, one understands the algorithms, and one understands the output, that it's explainable and even diagnosable. You know, we build devices like cars, and of course what we want to know from them is when they stop working, you know, why are they not working, and what do we do to fix it? And I think it's important that whatever methodologies we build for artificial intelligence need to have that same kind of property. We need to understand them well enough that we know how to fix them and guide them. I also don't worry that it's going to take over too much, because at the end of the day, most of the things we're trying to solve with artificial intelligence have to do with human well-being in some way or another. And what that means is that we optimize along some objective function that we think is the right one for humans. But in fact, that objective function is always a moving target. So in fact, the human always has to be in the loop. At the end of the day, if you actually get to a point where humans aren't doing anything, then your objective function has changed, because people will be so bored that they'll be looking for something to do. So in any case, that's my view on it. I'm not worried about it taking over too much. I think we need to jump in and not think that everything's going to be automatic. We ought to keep that human in the loop and figure out how do we build technology that does that.
Thanks, Gunnar. And Brian, how about you, given that ARL is looking at technologies that will ultimately be fielded with people making high-stakes decisions using them?
Yeah, so, you know, and I share all these concerns about the technology and where we are today in terms of, you know, the hurdles we face in making these things reliable, robust, and so on, all the sort of well-known science issues. I guess what worries me, a couple things. One is, because I fundamentally believe it's going to change the way we fight, then I worry in a couple of ways. One is that we implement properly, things are accelerating. It's very clear, right? And As technology has converged into smaller and smaller devices, we're seeing waves of convergence. Now I expect that to hit Army tactical operations relatively quickly. And so there's a managing change and pace question from a technology perspective, and also what we do with it on the battlefield. The other piece that scares me then is that as this becomes commoditized, the adversarial piece. I think that, you know, it's 10 years ago, quad rotors were not a commodity. Today, they're mass produced in China. And so that means that the autonomy comes along relatively cheaply in terms of software. So software production, algorithmic implementation, these become things. So you asked about worries. So, because I work for the Army, I guess those are my worries.
Thanks, Brian. How about you, Lisa?
Ditto, essentially. I don't want to belabor points. I would emphasize strongly that, first of all, I'm not worried of all the things that keep me up at night, and many things do. This isn't one of them. I think it's rather hyperbolic to claim that AI is a greater existential threat than North Korea. It's my opinion. However, I do strongly resonate with the point that, if anything, we have to be careful not to let the hyperbolic tendencies of people who aren't technical actually destroy the opportunity. Mm-hmm. So this is an area that is really ripe for great opportunity, but it's going to take a lot longer than people think to do the things that the visionaries are looking for it to do. And it's great to have vision, but as Thomas Edison said, and one of my favorite quotes, vision without execution is hallucination. And execution is the part that's really hard, and the folks who are actually in the trenches doing the work will tell you this is really hard, and it's hard for a lot of grungy, non-sexy reasons, mm-hmm. Particularly the data part. So a lot of excitement around deep learning algorithms, but the messy side is that it takes a lot of data, very well labeled, not just well labeled, well curated, able to be ingested into algorithms that are designed by others who may not necessarily have the expertise in the domain that you want to use those algorithms in. And it just takes, and Fei-Fei Li is a great example. For those of you who know who she is, most of you probably do. She spent 2 years in the trenches putting together that data set that became ImageNet, that ultimately advanced computer vision so profoundly. Great articles, by the way, being written now as she has wound that down, for those of you who are curious. She's a fabulous leader. But when she started doing that, people thought she was nuts because she wasn't doing the sexy stuff. She recognized that getting things done was about getting data out there for people to actually push and test their algorithms. There's a lot of that that still remains to be done. I know at IARPA, I know at InQtel, I know at many IBM, I know most of the places recognize that, and it's just going to be a long slog to stay focused and do what has to be done and do it in a rigorous fashion with all the validation that's required and with one of my personal pet peeves, establishing the appropriate metrics. So how do you know what success looks like? When people say to me, I get X percent accuracy, my first question is, well, what does that mean? How are you defining accuracy? That word in and of itself means nothing. So understanding what your application is drives what your metric is. And if you don't know how well you're doing today, which believe it or not, in many cases in the application domains of the intelligence community, we don't necessarily have quantitative understanding of how well we're doing today. It becomes very hard to set that bar of where we should be targeting our capabilities. So I hope I didn't babble on too much, but I just wanted to support the points that you guys made, that I think the greatest concern we should have is letting the hype get us into a poison the well situation, right? This is a really great opportunity, but it's one that has to be addressed with scientific rigor, as all technology should be.
Great. So on the point of opportunities, Kristen, starting with you again, what do you think are the greatest opportunities that haven't yet been seized? What's the low-hanging fruit right now in machine learning?
That's a great question. I feel like we're seizing parts of all kinds of opportunities, so I'm not sure I have an answer for what's the opportunity that hasn't been seized. I think the places where we can really make a difference have a lot to do with making use of the data that we have that is too much, too unstructured, too overwhelming for humans to look through, right? And so there are a variety of those problems that need to be defined really crisply that can address that data and make sense out of it and make it useful. And I think maybe one of the things that needs doing is fuller and more crisp definitions of what those sets of problems are. And I would like to see that be done in a way so that they can be shared, right? So that people can share their data to create the training sets that we need, and so that then the results transfer, at least to some extent. There's always going to be some mission adaptation and some differences in different situations, but I think we're doing sort of pieces of a variety of things, both to find the information, that data, and then to do the kind of sexier part of connecting the dots and finding patterns and making predictions based on what you find. But until we kind of do that underlying piece, I think there's still just a lot of information that's resident in everybody's data sets that's not being taken advantage of as much as it could be.
Thanks, Kristen. And sure. Gunnar, for IASD, are there problems where if you thought, well, if we had twice as many staff, we would go after this particular problem, and you just don't have the resources?
Certainly, it's all around all kinds of unstructured data, for example. So data that's kind of hard to deal with, doesn't come in spreadsheet format. You know, there's image databases, text, all those kind of things. But things you might not have thought about, like, you know, molecule structures, for example. All of these things are kind of complicated, hard to know what to deal with, how to deal with them, electronic medical records. So, you know, that's what I would say. If we had, you know, 100 more staff, we'd be going after a lot more of these different kinds of things. At the moment, we're having to pick and choose. I would say, in general, though, the opportunity that's available now is there's at least a couple of things. One is, I think, around building unsupervised analysis, which provides outputs that are richer than, say, you know, a linear equation describing your data. In other words, something that is more easily interrogated, is richer, and contains more information. So that's kind of a mathematical side of things, which, you know, I really like, given my background. But secondarily, also, the notion of making a justifiable and explainable artificial intelligence. There's a lot that one can do there, ways that one can set things up systematically, and I think that's a huge opportunity also, because it's going to allow you to get, you know, past skepticism in some ways, and also guarantee that we don't lose to the hype.
Brian, if ARL's 6.1 and 6.2 budget doubled tomorrow, where would you be making your key investments?
So There's just a real richness of research questions. But one of the things that we're starting to bet on for the long term is distributed. So we don't always have the advantage of a centralized kind of networking, and we have to deal with autonomy in the battlefield, that's driven by wireless. So to me, one of the things that I wish we entirely as a community would embrace is the notion of networking and autonomy merged. So we call this autonomous networking sometimes because, when you're in the soup and you're faced with wireless, and we move more and more and more towards networked warfare, that's then our greatest point of vulnerability. So I fundamentally believe that the combination of autonomy and networking is such that you're not going to have distributed collaborative autonomy without the network, obviously. But I don't think you're going to have the network without distributed collaborative autonomy. I think that this is a perfect marriage, and this is a place where I'd like to accelerate. We've been doing it onesie-twosie from a research perspective for a while. The issue becomes sort of discipline lanes. We don't traditionally work this way. The Army is not organized this way, for example. So going back to what I said earlier about convergence of technologies, this is a real challenge for us as to how do we organize or reorganize around some of this newer technology as it merges across different spaces.
And Lisa, one of your labs is Lab 41, focused on data science. And my sense is that you all have a unique perch in being able to look at what's going on in industry, what's going on in government, and as well as academic data scientists who want to do a tour in industry or government, of the problems that your staff think are most interesting, most compelling, which are the ones that you would highlight as being priorities?
So I think one of the most interesting ways to think about this domain, and this was just touched upon actually, is how you merge different disciplines together. So a couple of the things that we're looking at, and I heard the NVIDIA person speak about this morning at the panel. Cybersecurity is now, people are now starting to think, how can I bring machine learning tools to bear? One of the problems we're looking at is, can we understand if somebody's pivoting on the network based on essentially applying machine learning tools? The reason that's exciting to me is because it's fun to watch people who are experts in cybersecurity talk to people who are experts in machine learning. It's fun in a way that's kind of maybe a little diabolical. even more interesting, and Jason, I know this is an area of interest to you at a personal level in terms of passion, is in the bio arena. So one of the compelling questions that people are starting to ask, including at IARPA, including at InQtel, and some of the academics we know, is can we apply machine learning techniques to, for example, determine whether this specimen has been genetically engineered? Anytime you think about pattern recognition, classification problems, those kinds of things, ask yourself, is this the kind of problem I might want to apply to my mm-hmm. domain? And again, it's fun because it's even more interesting to watch biologists who I don't understand talk to people who have machine learning backgrounds. And when you can create those kinds of dynamics internally in your organization, and many of you have companies that have academics who have lots of experts in different domains, I think some of where we can really see value and excitement is around bringing people with very disparate disciplines together to say, I have a problem I've been working on for maybe decades even, and can machine learning and what it brings actually perhaps help me solve this problem? Mm-hmm. Again, be careful around hype, don't promise it to be done tomorrow, but I think it is worth really trying to push on that and bring people together who normally are not comfortable talking to each other because their language is so different and their perspectives are so different. So there's a lot of examples like that we're exploring in the labs, and we have the benefit of being small enough that we can literally sit together in the same place and have those conversations and try to understand what's going on. How many of you saw the article that came out a couple weeks ago now, I think University of Washington, where they showed they could hack machines with DNA. It's really a cool article. Try to get a cybersecurity expert together with a biology expert and try to really understand that. It's very compelling. It's very futuristic. It was a contrived approach, which they fully admitted, but it was to point to where the future might be as you bring these disciplines together. I personally get a lot of excitement out of seeing different disciplines come together and think about problems in new ways. I think that's part of what machine learning and deep learning have to offer.
So I saw a report earlier today that that the U.S. government in total has spent about $2 billion a year on AI research and development, while U.S. industry is spending over $50 billion a year. And I wanted to start with you, Lisa, since you have an unusual breadth of experience in government, industry, and FFRDCs from your time at DARPA, NASA, IARPA, Teledyne, InQtel.
Can't hold down a job.
No. So what do you think is the... what are the market failures that government should be focused on for its small sliver of this R&D? In that we're probably not going to have a $50 billion U.S. government R&D budget for AI. Where should government be focusing its dollars?
Right. So the government obviously wants to leverage wherever it can. And again, I think for those of you who heard the panel earlier this morning, Don Myricks really emphasized this point, said it very eloquently. The government really does need to think about where it can leverage what's going on, and I think it does that, and that's, again, why things like InQtel exist. I think it's why government contractors try very hard to understand what the government challenges are and try to direct their own IRAD to get ahead of where those problems are, and I think that's something the government needs to make sure it's continuing to communicate, frankly, honestly and openly with the government contractors in its base to say, guys, let me explain to you what we're concerned about and how you might help us get ahead. So there is a lot of ways to take advantage of that. I will say, in my early days at DARPA, my boss at the time, Dr. Tether, had a saying which I always liked a lot. He always said it was the size of the idea, not the size of your budget, that matters. And some of his favorite programs were actually the ones that were the smallest in terms of budget. One of them was mine, that's how I know. That always stuck with me because I think we get enamored sometimes way too much with how much money is going at something, how much money a company has raised. You know, it's a billion-dollar company, therefore it really must know what it's doing. A lot of times, I would say some of the real sparks of innovation and opportunity come from maybe the less championed, more under-the-radar types of activities that maybe aren't attracting a lot of dollars but are being done very well. And again, with rigor and discipline and dedication to getting things done. So keep in mind, it's not just about the money. It's about the idea.
That's great. Please, Scott.
To that end, also, you know, artificial intelligence is very sort of sexy and so forth. But in fact, some very small parts of what I would call artificial intelligence are maybe not that way. And I'm thinking in particular of questions about false positives coming up all over the place, you know, in anti-money laundering and financial institutions, you know, keeping jet aircraft maintained, cybersecurity itself, all kinds of situations where you have large groups of humans, you know, doing really boring stuff where they, in fact, find out that, you know, it's one in a million that it actually turns out right. So one person may never actually even find a case, but nevertheless, they've got to be working on it. And so, you know, it's not the stuff of, you know, Scientific American articles, but it adds tremendous value because it makes those people more efficient. It means that maybe you can move them onto other projects, whatever. So I would say, in addition to not just the dollars, it's not also all about the hype or all about what sounds the prettiest.
Gunnar, to follow up on that, so yeah. IASDE has its roots in some DARPA and NSF-funded research and topological data analysis. What do you see as the role of those kinds of seed investments by government? And is government missing any opportunities right now in investing in the next IASDE?
I just hope that they're aware, the agencies are of AI. I mean, it's hard not to be aware of it. But I would say, if they could do investments like that, I think in my own area of expertise, which is, you know, mathematics and in fact pure mathematics going back, I would dearly love to see the National Science Foundation, and in particular DMS, the math side there, say, actually, let's go and do some artificial intelligence. It's going to rub some people the wrong way because people are used to doing particular kinds of math, and, you know, mathematicians don't like to be, told what to do. You know, but in fact, you know, if you could push it just a little way, if you could say something like, let's have a project at making deep learning understandable, or deep learning justified. Suppose we had that. That's a problem that mathematicians could address. And I think there's often a tendency to kind of stick with, you know, well, we do these areas. And, you know, that's and to sort of take something new like that, sometimes I think government agencies are a little bit stiff that way.
Brian, when ARL is thinking about making an investment in machine learning, how do you all make sure that it doesn't duplicate work that's already occurring either in industry or universities?
That's a critical question. I mean, we're always faced with that issue. I go back to the 90s, and I'm a cold warrior, and we were doing a lot of things in networking, and we faced the same sort of budgetary imbalance between what was going on, say, in cellular and what the Army needed. And so we're constantly, you know, looking for where we're going to place our small bets. You know, I see this generally, you know, this is a toolbox, and these tools are of increasing variety, and it's interesting at the lab because everybody owns AI now, because everybody's using AI, whether you're doing material design or whatever it is, you know, AI is coming into it. So I mean, it's not just putting money into AI label, right? It's how you bring AI to fruition within your own lane. So I think that's a critical piece. I think another critical piece for us, especially in times of change, so when you have a strong technology like AI, machine learning, which is, you know, although many of the pieces are relatively old mathematically, you know, now we're able to deal with the large data sets and technologically because of Moore's Law or whatever we want to call that, that it's important that we form really interesting, robust teams. And I like to think ARL's been a leader in this space because we do collaborative research alliances where we work with teams of academics for 10 years. And so this is like a third of a working lifetime. And we do this with large OTAs, for example. I think we need to do more in the commercial government lab academic space, especially when something becomes compressed and especially when it can be transitioned rapidly, like AI algorithmically can be. You know, it tends to be more to the software. I don't have to invent a new circuit. We need to think about this from a business model perspective, being the only government guy up here. Well, no, I'm sorry. But
I'm just asking questions.
I think we can do more in this space of, you know, of teaming across and thinking about the business model is important.
That's great. Thanks, Brian. Kristen, you at IBM, given IBM's size and the number of projects that it does with government, you probably have an understanding of where things can go sideways in government contracts. I'm curious about your experience of when you've seen AI-related technologies that have been embedded the right way in a government system and when it hasn't gone so well, and what lessons you've learned from that.
Yeah, so I think the main lesson that we've learned is to be very mission-centric, that even when you have a very general AI capability that's applicable to a lot of things, when we try to kind of roll it out to everyone in the same way and say, just use this capability, it doesn't go very well. And when we are connected to a particular mission and we really are focusing on how we're going to use that underlying capability for the way they work, their workflow, as well as adapting it to their particular data, the particularities of how their problem is constructed, that tends to be much more effective. And so I think that's a major thing that we've learned. Another definitely has to do with the expectations matter that has been mentioned several times, right? That if somebody comes in and they're looking for, I want AI to help me find bad guys, right? That's probably not gonna go really well. If we can have a conversation about what they're trying to do, and the goal is to find the most threatening behaviors in some particular data corpus where they have labeled a number of examples of which behaviors are threatening and how threatening they are, right, then that's going to be a much more effective project. And there's a lot of room in between, and there's a lot of room to have that conversation, but we need to get there before we start saying, okay, here's the AI technique, use this.
seems like government customers also have some different needs from commercial customers. Mm-hmm. I mean, beyond the sort of certification and accreditation requirements of the networks that they work on, which can be cumbersome, it seems like there's been an increased demand for explainability, yes, transparency. One other topic that we've seen a lot of at IARPA is a concern related to robustness to adversarial inputs or adversarial machine learning, in which a image can be altered in ways that are relatively imperceptible to human observers, but can fool an image classifier. Can you describe how big of an issue do you think this is, given that as we think about incorporating machine learning into critical systems, their vulnerability to spoofing or to denial and deception attacks could become significant? And what steps could we take to overcome those vulnerabilities?
Yeah, so absolutely, and I think those two points are very much intertwined, because the more you have explainability, the more you can recognize where perhaps something went awry. And I think absolutely we need systems that are kind of showing their work and explaining what the steps were and where they got to. And a lot of times, you know, sort of the first reaction to that request is, well, this is a statistical model. There isn't really an explanation the way there would be if I had implemented a rule. And that's true, but it's also true that there are certain features that were important in that statistical model. And those features, and you know which of those features were triggered by the example you're looking at. So I think there are things we can do to try to kind of represent in a human consumable way what was salient about this instance to this model, and therefore, and what did that lead to? And also, I think a big piece of that is recognizing when the example is distant from things that we trained on or is different from it in significant ways, right? So we have a confidence level often that reflects, like, within our model, how confident are we that something's true? But also, we need to reflect, well, how much does this really look like what I trained on? Because if it doesn't look a lot like what I trained on, then I may not be doing very well. There may be things that I didn't account for. And to recognize that automatically and surface that, I think, will help with both of those concerns.
Thanks, Krista.
Sure.
And Gunnar, so, I mean, of the sort of typical attacks that that have been in research where you say have a school bus that has a few, you know, pixels changed and now it's recognized as a tank, or a porcupine. How vulnerable are other kinds of machine learning systems to those sorts of attacks?
Yeah, I think, well, let me talk about that one directly, if I could, for a moment. I think, actually, one can interpret it as a problem about being smart about what features do you feed in. In other words, when you feed in the features that are just the pixels, you are going to find little micro patterns that actually are not relevant to the overall thing, and you may learn on those micro features. If you're smart about the features, though, if you believe that they are really incorporating what humans might see in that situation, you'll probably do better. So, for example, there's a very standard data set of digits called the MNIST data set, where you can actually be adversarial even on that very simple data set by just changing background information. And so the background, a 2 with a certain kind of background will get recognized as a 6. But if you add features that, and there are ways of doing that, and I think that is an object, something that should be the object of research, is what are the smart features to feed to the deep learning? We shouldn't always just insist that, well, it's gotta be the pixels in the image. Mm. Maybe it needs to be something smarter.
Thanks, Gunnar.
You know, an interesting thing happened along the road of deep learners. If you look at a deep learner as a function approximator, it has millions of parameters that you're learning within that box, right? And in so doing, we got this fantastic body of function approximators. And if you have sufficient data, could be a huge amount of data, that's properly curated, then you can learn a function such as a, you know, find a classifier. Whereas if you ask me to write down what is the functional form of that classifier, I have no idea. And this is, you know, this is super terrific news, except for the fact that you have millions of parameters and I have no idea how to interpret those parameters. But I think this points to a bigger question when you talk about robustness. And that is that these, while you can make a standalone classifier, you can make a box which does the classification, you can make an end-to-end controller for a car, right? People have demonstrated this. Nevertheless, it's a bad idea.
right? It's the question becomes, how do I exploit that deep learner, that function approximator, in a larger architecture, right? How do I bring side information in? How do I interface with human and so on? So we, you know, traditionally from the 90s, when I first heard talks by Professor Widrow and others doing, you know, basically the same architecture that we're using now, we just couldn't implement it on a massive deep scale. You know, that was a black box. Input, output, solve my problem, done, move on to the next problem. We shouldn't view it that way, right? We should view it as a tool which is going to be embedded in an architecture, and there's going to be many checks and balances. And I also completely agree, and, you know, there's a fairly active theoretical research space now trying to get around the theory of these devices to understand, right? That's a good place for investment, actually.
Qtel has set up a pretty unique and valuable data set in SpaceNet. And it seems like that kind of training data is sort of the grist for so much productive technology development. What sort of work do you think on this question of adversarial machine learning needs to be incorporated into training data that we use to develop various technologies to help make those systems more robust if somebody decides to disguise their tanks as school buses?
So, yeah, I think I don't really have a deep answer on that. I think that is a concern. But I think Brian was touching on a point that I hope gets really amplified here, which is you're not going to use these tools by themselves, at least not for mission applications, right? So it really requires, I think, in terms of the skills of how to understand how to use these, a systems perspective, right? A holistic perspective. I have some of a background in CFD. I worked in that domain for a while. And a lot of the problems, I mean, it was smaller scale. Yes, Reynolds, Average, Navier-Stokes only have, you know, tens to hundreds of parameters versus millions, but you still don't really know how those parameters are individually being tweaked. You have the same problems when you're designing an aircraft, and then you compare, and I saw this at NASA, you run a competition and say, run your CFD code against the wind tunnel data, and none of them match the wind tunnel data. Mm. So it's actually not a new concept to say models aren't perfect, and we better understand their limitations, and we have to understand how we're going to incorporate them from a system perspective into our mission approach, right? And I think that's in part the opportunity as well, because that's where you put in redundancies. You're not going to just look at the image in a mission-critical application. You're going to look at other signatures and other modalities, just as you do today when you try to counter denial and deception activities, right? We're not so dumb, hopefully, as to just rely on one modality when we're making a critical decision. We're not going to do that here either. So I think part of where I think the secret sauce of how our community can really leverage this opportunity called machine learning is to think about the systems perspective. And again, I think a lot of people in this audience work for companies who have a lot of knowledge in how to bring complex systems together, where individually you need to understand where their limitations and weaknesses are and how you can take advantage of the, you know, the orthogonal, if you will, failure modes. I do think, Brian, that's such an important point that I wanted to emphasize it. And I think for any particular thing you want to jab at machine learning, and there's a lot of examples, the example you gave is just one, and it's a fun one because everyone, have you guys all seen the panda example? You know, it looks like a panda, but they classify it as a gibbons, right? It's fun to say, look, AI is limited because you can fool it, but you can fool most models, honestly. For those of us who have had years of research in computational modeling, you can fool pretty much any model.
You can fool humans,
absolutely. And so the question is, from a mission perspective, how do you put in place a system approach that mitigates that and understand how, as you're integrating these powerful tools, you understand their limitations and design accordingly? So it's not really a specific answer to your question, but I think that's a really important point to get across here.
That's great. Thanks, Lisa. So we have just a few minutes before we turn it over to the Q&A from the audience. In those remaining minutes, I wanted to just go down the line, ask what you're most excited about as a technology that's on the horizon or a research result that you've recently seen that you think will ultimately lead to a technology, just either within your own company, within your own organization, or outside of it.
So I guess this is sort of a semi-answer, but I'm excited about the combination of machine learning and the Internet of Things and really being able to do both of those things at scale, it gives us the opportunity to do so much more than we've had before. And we're looking at things like giving you advice on your equipment as we sense things on it, and you can go past that to sensing what's happening or perhaps directing the sensors or things like that. And I think that combination of capabilities is really, has a lot of promise.
I have a very specific one. So our company produces some rich network models of data, not linear approximations or anything like that. So they're quite rich. And so it doesn't naturally fit in that deep learning would be something that could produce such a model, because deep learning tends to produce classifiers. But we found a way to use deep learning to select the correct model within our framework, which I think is going to lead us very quickly to being able to do a lot of things that we couldn't do before, because we're presented with too big an array of these models, and we might not find the right one.
Brian?
That's such a great question. So I'll mention a couple things. One is, I mentioned before this merger of autonomy and networking. I think that this is going to finally create a new paradigm for mobile ad hoc networks. We've been fighting these problems for decades, and the problem just gets worse. So I believe that the merger and thinking about the problem as a combined thing is a very exciting direction. The other thing that I'm really excited about is the merging of control and cognition. So looking in the autonomy space, we're getting pretty good at moving robots around now. We can fly them in here, we can go into unknown environments, we can roll around on the ground. So I think the basic underlying control phenomenology is now pretty well understood, especially for flyers. Even indoors, if you're flying, we can do a lot. I think that the next frontier now is adding cognition into that space. So adding on the ability to perceive in an environment, to put semantic labels on, and so on. And all those tools are now appearing. And so I'm really excited about that coming merger.
So I always hate these questions, because there's never one answer, right? But I do think in general the theme that you're hearing here is the right one. It's how you combine the machine learning opportunities with other cutting edge technologies. And people are gonna pick their passion, right, for that answer. On the other hand, I would say, even in the area of computer vision, where people might think, oh, that's a solved problem, ImageNet has shown that, it's not. And I think even if you just take an area like that, and part of why we did SpaceNet is because, as you guys, many of you in the audience well know, space imagery is nothing like internet imagery in a lot of ways that are important to these algorithms. And so that's why we decided with Digital Globe to put out high quality labeled space imagery data, because when we ported over ImageNet tools, they worked okay but not great against satellite imagery. So we recognize that problem. I bring that up because even things like that, there's great opportunity for advancement. There's opportunity to understand how better to infer road networks, which has a diverse application domain, as you guys well know, everything from humanitarian to commercial to military and intelligence applications. Things like, and again, I have personal passion for space, so being able to process off-nadir imagery is something we can't do very well today, even with humans, but certainly not with machine learning capabilities. And if we could, you can greatly enhance essentially your temporal resolution. For a given constellation, you can improve your temporal revisit time if you can take better off-nadir shots and use the information. So this is pulling on that theme of machine learning as an enabler for a variety of pick-your-passion technologies and problems. And that's why I don't like this question, because it's going to be, my particular passion is space, so I'll give you 10 answers in that. And, I think the way you should look at machine learning is, wow, there's tremendous opportunities for applications. Think about how it can be used for your passion, but please do not fall victim to hype. Take your time, do it right.
Well, thank you for providing such a good answer to a question you hate. Well done. So, first question from the audience is, what steps can government IT infrastructure and data managers take now to be ready for AI capabilities that may come online in the next 2 to 5 years? Kristen, since you have some direct experience getting AI capabilities onto government IT infrastructure, you want to take this one?
Sure. So definitely there are certification and accreditation issues, as you mentioned, and sort of starting early with what the requirements are going to be for that is huge. And looking for data that can be used to train is also a huge piece of this, preferably data that can be shared. I think a question that sometimes comes up is, are there constraints around using a model that was trained on data that has certain constraints on it? In an environment where you maybe don't have that same limitations, can you take the model and use it elsewhere? Or are you going to have to train separately if you have different data sets that have different limitations on their access? But more generally than that, if we can start creating those crisp problem definitions and labeled data sets as a side effect of the work that people are doing now, then we are so much farther ahead when we come in to try to use machine learning to address those problems. So that's the other activity I would really put in a plug for.
Great, thanks, Kristen. Brian, I think this next one is for you. Sort of on the heels of Bob Work's discussions of the third F set relying on human-machine teaming, an example of Centaur chess where combinations of humans and machines outperform either in isolation. Can you talk about the future of human-machine teaming to achieve greater outcomes than possible without the collaboration?
Yeah, you know, this is an interesting question. Even when you combine autonomous elements, am I going to do better than, right? You know, you run into that nine women going to have a baby in a month question. This question of distributed is really a key one. I think it's going to have a big impact on the heels of this notion of offset strategy. We put forward a tactical offset strategy, a sort of framework for research where we believe that distributed collaborative intelligence systems will be a game changer for the Army. The thinking has to be very, very heterogeneous, large and small. How do we combine the various elements of humans? It's not just humans and machines, it's sensors. How do we move sensors around? How do we use autonomy? How do we use high-performance computing tactically? You can do a lot in a shoebox-sized computer, and I can bring a bunch of those along with me, and then the question is, what am I going to do with it? I don't know, but I know I can bring it. I know I want to bring it. I'm not sure what I'm going to do with it. I hope I'm answering the question.
That's great. And Gunnar, I think, it seems like IASD tools depend on human interaction a fair amount. Can you describe what you see as opportunities there?
We have various different things, actually. There's a tool for data analysis, which is indeed, human interacted. And I think there's lots of possibilities for improving that. It builds maps of data sets, and so I think those maps can be made more and more interactive, and so that one can work with them in better ways. But actually, the company is pushing very hard for making the building of artificial intelligence applications on top of this analytic layer easier and faster. And so, that is something that I regard as a huge opportunity. The idea that it's actually quite simple to put together something that will work for the customer as opposed to a very much longer, more complicated development process.
Lisa, to your point earlier about the difficulties of measuring accuracy or what is the right kind of performance to measure, when you're looking at teaming tools with human analysts through the pilot projects that InQtel does, how do you measure the performance of that combination of the tool and the analyst together?
I should turn that back on you, since you and I've had many conversations about that. I think generally speaking, when you're thinking about transitioning technology in this domain in particular, it is hopefully going to be one which you're enhancing the analyst's experience, and to Brian's point, hoping that you're getting better outcomes than with the analysts by themselves. To answer that question, you first have to know objectively how well you're doing in the current workflow. And it's surprising how sometimes you can't get that answer. So, for example, in SpaceNet, we put a lot of time into thinking about the metric we wanted to use. We called it SpaceNet, not surprisingly, because we were giving homage to ImageNet. But ImageNet used a different metric. They used a precision-weighted metric called mean average precision. And that makes a lot of sense if you're developing an application that's all about retrieving, right? So give me pictures with cats in them. Every picture that comes back should have a cat in it. You don't care so much about the pictures you missed with cats. But for the application domain we care about, you care about the things you miss. So you have to weight recall as well as precision. So we chose, you know, this F1 score. And then we started asking, what's good enough? What is operationally useful for an F1 score? What precision and recall matters to the analysts? And you get answers like, it depends, right? Which isn't surprising. Well, we just hope we do better than we do now. Okay, well, how well do you do now? It's not necessarily always the case that you can get that ground truth or baseline, I should say, thing to compare against. And therefore, it becomes very difficult to know, well, given I'm going to have to put real money into developing this new capability, i.e. I've got to build training data, I've got to train people how to use it, blah, 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 it's a cost to change your workflow. And you better understand if the cost is going to be worth the performance you're going to see, right? This is an obvious business 101 kind of statement, but if we don't do those steps, then we can't have transition of technology. And so whether an analyst is there or not, it's really about how well are you doing today with that analyst, and what are you shooting for to augment in terms of getting a quantitative, measurable improvement in performance. And we're frankly sometimes not equipped to do that. And it's because it's hard, actually. So, and you and I've had many conversations about this over the years, right?
Yeah.
I used to be pretty tough on Jason about defining metrics for his programs at
IRPA. I still have your voice on my shoulder asking me those hard questions.
It's really hard to know what does success look like. But if you can't define that, you're going to be, if you run a business, you guys know, you don't get to just spend money to spend money, right? I mean, you don't last long in your job if you do. You better have a demonstrable return on that investment.
Great answer. Thanks, Lisa. Brian, one for you. What opportunities exist to put machine learning at the end of the sensor for things like model-based collection? So having online learning or real-time decision-making at the point of the sensor on what to collect, when to collect, where to collect?
So there's a ton of opportunity there, whether it's, sensor selection, fusion. Fusion is a huge problem, which deep learning opens the door to. And we can think about fusing active and passive sensors, for example, something we just don't do otherwise. We have no statistical models for. I think a really interesting basic answer to that question is looking at policy. What is the policy? It's really hard to learn a dynamic policy for selecting sensors on the move. If I want to move sensors, what sensors should I activate? There's an energy cost, there's a potential for revealing cost, et cetera, et cetera. How do you find a good policy? And one potential answer is reinforcement learning. So now we can use the deep learner to learn a policy with various caveats about how long it takes to train and et cetera, but these problems are generally combinatorial and frustrated us for a long time, and so now we have an interesting potential for reinforcement learning in that space.
Great, thanks, Brian. Next question: how do you see AI affecting the job market? Such as job elimination and its broader effect on society. I'm going to rescope this a little bit to focus just on, say, national intelligence jobs and the kinds of skill sets that we might be looking for in national intelligence over the next decade, and whether that is likely to change as a result of these tools. So assume that the job market is the same size, but might be of a different composition. That is, we're looking for different skills. What would those skills be? Kristen, what do you think?
So I think absolutely that it will not shrink. I mean, I agree with that premise. And I think there will be a need for skills that are more in the family of data science and people who are kind of using machine learning tools to explore and understand their data. I think there may be more of an emphasis on things like creating the training sets and working with the people developing the tools in order to get the tools to operate, rather than a sole focus or a primary focus on manually doing the task. And I think also, I'm not even sure we have an exact description of what these skill sets are, but we're definitely going to have systems that have much more of the hybrid flavor that we've been talking about here, right? Where the machine is doing a part and the human is doing a part, and you need human judgment that's going to interpret the machine's explanation of what it did and make some determination. And people who have kind of the combination of skill sets that lead that to go well, I think are going to be very much in demand.
I think what it argues for is it's people with a general ability to learn going forward, right? That is to say, you know, when back in the day, people had to learn to use Word or Excel or whatever, and that was a learning curve, and some people jumped on it, and others did not. And so I think it's going to call for that, but at this higher level. I would also add that it should also be reasonable for government to employ a number of developers as well as data analysts. You know, in other words, if you make the development process not too onerous, if you make it, you know, easy and something that can be done more straightforwardly, then maybe the government should be hiring developers as well.
I'm firmly in the camp of we team with machines, they don't replace us, and I think this is in line with how we should fight, and I think so. I'm extremely optimistic in that space, perhaps too much so, but that's how I see it. I think the skills that will emerge will be, how do we use the machine? How do we team with the machine? The Army and all the services, I'm always astounded by how well and amazingly so our young people are trained to work as a team. Mm-hmm. I just find this astounding. I think this is a wonderful strength of our entire system. Mm-hmm. People can improvise, they're so intelligent. You want to meet some impressive people, go to the military academy. Walk up to any student. I'm just astounded by these people. And, you know, we're trying to develop the technology to team with them. So in that sense, you know, we've got to get after learning how to do that.
Great. Thanks, Brian. Lisa?
Yeah, I think everyone here made great points. I really echo Brian's point. And I think it's really about making sure, as stupidly obvious as this sounds, that people understand that the most critical asset you have is learning how to think critically. And whether you're a physicist or an engineer or God help you, a mathematician, I'm just kidding. you know, it's really, do you think about your problem in the right way? Do you understand how to look at the big picture? Do you understand how to ask yourself critically what it is you're trying to solve and how you're going to measure success and what tools you're going to bring together and how you're going to validate their additive value? You don't have to be an expert in a particular domain to have that ability. You can learn Excel, Word, Python, you know, pick your favorite. It's really about making sure you're hiring people who are critical thinkers. And, you know, that's a skill that will always be important. When 10 years from now, when the next panel's sitting up here or virtualed in, you know, you'll be talking about whatever the next craze is, and I don't think the importance of critical thinking is ever going to go away.
Thanks. So with only 30 seconds left, I want to ask the panelists if they'll be available outside in the hallway if folks have follow-up questions. Yeah, good. And I also want to thank the panel for a much more uplifting discussion than I would have expected following Putin's remarks or Elon Musk's tweet. It sounds like we might confuse pandas for gibbons every once in a while, but we'll probably be okay. So my thanks to the panelists.